But yeah, White Yardie, Wagwan.
What are you saying, man?
Huh?
There, brother.
Yeah, man. First time we're having a proper conversation, because enough times I see you, we just hail each other up and do you get what I'm saying?
Quick. True.
Yeah. But every once in a while, I want to sit down with certain people like that.
On my phone.
You're sitting on it, brother.
No.
Every once in a while, I want to sit down with certain people and just have a conversation with them and get to know them properly while we, you know what I mean? Because, yeah, you've been out here for a little while. Like, you've been out here for a little while still. But, like, there's a story behind you even being here in the first place. Do you get me?
Mm-hmm.
So you was born in Jamaica, yeah?
All right, so, I know they have to start with that first.
Yeah.
Like, I know that. It's predictable, everybody.
Of course. People are looking, like, people that don't know you obviously look and be like, it's not a surprise.
Yeah. But it's a standard. I have a documentary I'm working on.
Okay.
I've already shot the pilot already. The pilot's there.
Yeah.
Ready. We've been I presented it to two people. They're looking at it now.
Yeah.
So we're looking to do a full, like, documentary. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm just waiting to see which one comes back with an offer.
Yeah.
They might not come back. I might have to independently do it.
Yeah.
You know I mean? Maybe get you fit.
Yeah, come on.
Me and you do
yeah,
that.
Yeah. Come on, man.
It's something I'm working on because it's something people have been asking for a long time. It's out there. It's on social. It's out there on internet. If you Google me, it comes up.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, the story is my mother and my father both come from England, some part in England. I don't know. My dad is one of them man there where you look upon him, he passed away now. But when you look upon him, he look like he could come from a few different places. You know what I mean?
Racially ambiguous, they call it.
Yeah, like he have a look to him like, yo, you don't know. Some people feel like he come from Greek or somewhere like Greece and a place like that. So he have different features. However, he was so in tune with Jamaican culture.
How old was he when you passed?
When he passed?
Yeah, when he passed. How old was you when he passed?
Oh, he passed away 6 years now.
Okay.
So not that long ago, but
early
in my comedy career.
Oh, okay.
But so anyway, he's been into the Jamaican music from a young age. He grew up around Brixton.
Mm.
A lot of his friends are from Brixton. A lot of his friends were Jamaican, and he just went there and started to live out there.
Fell in love with the culture.
Yeah, man, and set up businesses out there. He had a strip club out there. Mm. He had a sound system.
Shout out to Shades. Yeah, man. Let me tell you something, boy. I had some funny times in Shades.
His one was called Hotline.
Hotline, okay.
Yeah, Hotline.
Well, that doesn't still exist, though, because I ain't heard of
it's
that.
It's still there.
It's still there?
It's still there, but which, it's not his part? No more. It's in an area called Brampton.
Okay. Yeah, okay,
so,
okay.
But yeah, he just, you know, he went there and loved the place. His mom and mother moved out there, and over years they just stayed there. And then my mother got pregnant.
Yeah.
She flew back here, gave birth.
Have you? And then.
And then 3 months later, she went back to Jamaica with me.
Yeah.
And I was there until I was 18. And you grew up there.
Yeah. Until you was 18. Mad. Yeah, so. What was that like for you though? Like, cause it's funny having this conversation because I think as a black man, in a country that is predominantly black, you don't feel black really, do you? You because you're just around people that are just so like you.
Just normal.
Yeah. In somewhere like England, see, like for me where I went to school, it was predominantly white.
So I
knew very quickly, that I was a black boy in it.
Yeah.
But you, like, what was it like for you? Like, when did you, like, Was there a point in growing up, where you felt different?
No.
Okay.
100% didn't, like, because this is the thing is I tell people this, in Jamaica, I never ever knew about racism. Mm. I never even witnessed it. I was probably being more racist to white people than anybody else. Because when I used to see white people, I used to be like, yo, watch them white today. I didn't look at myself no different because nobody treated me different.
Yeah.
Like, teachers didn't treat me different. Friends didn't treat me different. I went through everything they did.
Mm.
Schooling, like walking to school, riding a bicycle to school if you have one, getting in a taxi with all 100 kids in one taxi. Yes, I mean,
let's talk about that quickly. See, in Jamaica, yeah, if you trying to get somewhere in a taxi, just know you might jump in that taxi. By the time you get to your destination, all 10 man in the car,
And worse, when I grew up, I'm very, very small, you know, so when you get in a taxi, they might tell you, small one, them, go pan lap.
Yeah. So you got to sit on the stranger's lap.
And even when you're go high school, and they might tell you, so, and you think to yourself, yeah, big man, you know, man. No, man, me not sell nobody lap. Make somebody, all right, you're a big man, cool.
Yeah.
Yo, sit on nine lap, and you put all on big girl in your lap, now your leg, them dead. When you stop, you can't have, come on, slide out. But no, man, I didn't experience anything different because I went through everything that my friends were going through.
Yeah.
Every single thing, beatings, everything you can experience, I experienced.
Yeah.
So I didn't feel no different.
What part did you grow up in?
St. Elizabeth, Black River.
Okay, yeah. No, St. Elizabeth. So, do you know what, it's funny, yeah? I was at my good friend's house recently, and we was having a conversation and someone said to me, it was so random, we were just playing cards, so random, and someone just said to me, so what's your opinion on colorism? Then I was like, we're just having a good time, I don't know, like, where did this come from? Like, we're just playing cards. Like, I didn't know how to answer the question because it was so we're literally just talking about something. So you get what I'm saying? So then, like, my brethren came, and then he realized that it was awkward or whatnot. But he then broke the awkwardness by mentioning something that was quite interesting. He was like, he said, like, colorism in particular doesn't exist in a certain way, like how it does in Jamaica, in a sense that he was like, when you go to a place like Jamaica, sometimes you associate someone of white skin with money, or someone with white skin as, you know, they come from some element of wealth. Do you get what I'm saying? And I thought about that and I was like, that's quite an interesting take. Like, what would you say about that?
I agree with what that is definitely, because in Jamaica, it is definitely, they feel like, it's like a lot of Jamaican mothers would always say to their sons, make sure you get a girl with good looking, good hair.
Yeah.
The answer I mean is like, they try to put that in their minds from early, you know what I mean? Like, oh, she pretty, she brown, and
yeah.
You know what I mean? So it always feels like in Jamaica, they would say, yes, people who have higher color come from wealth. You're white or you're red, as I say, red or white, you're rich, you have money. But again, that's still not the case. You understand what I mean? Because there is people out there with fair skin, white, even white people out there that don't have it.
Because
I've been through stuff where, remember the day when I have a beard with all that fob, you know fob?
Yeah, of course.
Yes, that is, for those who don't know, that's washing powder you use to wash your clothes.
Yeah.
When I know soap and we have fob, if you wash with fob, get the fob and soap up yourself. So, it's for me, it's a very, I understand it.
Yeah.
But at the same time, because I how can I say it? I wasn't at that.
Yeah.
That point where they were looking at me like that.
Like that, yeah.
I didn't experience
That's
that
fair.
Type of thing. But I agree with your friends.
What was school like though, anyway? What was school in Jamaica like?
Why? It was
tough.
It was very hard. Teachers don't teach you for learn all this. They beat you for learn, man. Trust me, man. Like, beating.
Like, ready.
Beating is part of the culture, man.
Yeah, isn't
I know
it?
They've changed it now.
Have they, yeah?
Yeah, over the last couple of years, they stopped beating kids in school, which recently I went back to Jamaica. I'm doing some work with my primary school.
Yeah.
I'm helping fixing up the computer room there and things like that.
That's good to hear.
So, when I went back there, I was asking the teachers, I was like, we used to get beaten, you know, like, and I'm like, yes. And I said, me say, I want to teach them, we beat me enough. And I said, remember, you used to kill me with liquor when I said, you used to get too much trouble. I'm saying, yeah, but, we beat them, did hot, man. I'm saying, so how you find it now that they're not beating them more? I'm saying, it's harder now.
Really?
Because the children have attitude now.
Okay.
Because they know, you cannot beat me.
Yeah.
You cannot beat me. And I'm like, it's wrong. Because I don't feel like beating did anything bad to us, because it sounds bad in a way, but let me just break it down. It's not beating to an extent where they might whip you and I cut you up and I abuse you. It's not that. It's it's what we grew up knowing. So it wasn't a bad thing. I feel like beatings were very good because it made you know, okay, I cannot do that no more. But when there's no form of discipline there, they will continue to get away with it. You understand what I mean? But for me, school was fun. I enjoyed it.
If they, the thing is, if they've got rid of that recently, then, you know, for a while, for some years, obviously, some youths are going to use that against the teachers and that. But I think, like, when more years pass and that becomes a real thing in the past, then I don't know if it would just, I don't know if it becomes a thing anymore. Do you get what I'm saying? Because it becomes such a distant memory from anyone. Because, like, there used to be people here, innit? My mum used to get licks when she was in school.
The cane or something.
But obviously, when I was going to school, when we was going to school, we didn't even think about that at all. But, like, you still had teachers that were able to discipline you in a mentally more than anything. And I guess that's a gift, innit? That's more, that might be more a gift or a certain teaching style or whatever it may be. Because really, you know what, as a teacher, you could probably beat someone, but that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get their attention. You might not even beat them.
It might not even hurt. So me
there
at school, and we know a boy with me and my friend, and rather than get beaten like 3 times a week from the same things over and over again, and like, because it's not like it's not beating to like torture you, like physically.
It's to get your attention,
it's like a wake up thing. It's almost like the first time your mother smack you or something like that, you know what I mean, like bop. You get me? Like, just for the record, I don't beat my children.
Yeah, of course. Yeah,
let's make that very clear. You know what I mean? Like, before next thing you know, we get locked up. But no, I enjoyed school. I really did. I didn't finish school. I dropped out in year 10.
Okay.
Yeah, I got halfway to year 10.
You didn't get licks enough then?
Huh?
You didn't get enough licks?
No, not I did, but the problem...
You firm the licks?
Yeah, after a while, they kind of get used to it, but you don't get as many.
Yeah.
That's the truth. You don't get as many. You know, once the beatings weren't regular. Yeah. When you go to school, they're not regular because you don't want it no more.
Hmm.
And it's kind of embarrassing as well.
Yeah, of course.
Because in high school, they did it different from primary school, higher school, secondary school.
Yeah.
So they did it different. Yeah. Like they would do it in front of the whole school.
Oh, wow.
So they would do it at devotion, assembly.
Serious?
So they have the
whole... Oh, you get licks in assembly?
Yeah, man. They have the whole class out and then them call you. And all that.
Oh my god. That's and, not,
you know,
that's
torture. Put out your hand. You put out your hand.
Yeah.
Pop. Put out your next hand. Pop. Put out your next. Pop. And it's a collect the beat name. Like somebody warrior. Yeah.
That's physical and mental torture, right?
But the whole school, imagine that. And you have all some girls where you're trying to talk, you know, and them see you have your firm, all the tears, can't even cry.
You hold them back.
Like, you know what I mean? But it's fun, man. I enjoyed school, like, fully. Everything about it.
Was you doing comedy in Jamaica as well?
No. Far from comedy.
So how did it, like, what was the period in between, obviously, growing up there, leaving school, like, well, leaving school in year 10, and then, obviously, between then and 18, like, what was going on then
for you? So the reason why, like, my father, he came back to England for a period of time.
Yeah.
And I used to live with him. And my mother, she left to go America, and then I think she came over to here. So at that time, I was like, my father was like, yo, I'm going to go to England for some time. You want to come? And I'm like, nope. England enough for me. Foreign enough for me. Like, I want to go to foreign, them cool country. That's exactly how it was. Cause, I said, every time I used to see my father leave for go to England, he might bring some big old jacket with him. I said, yo, I got them cool country they go do, man. Yo, Jamaica, my yard, I stay here. So, and he's like, right, cool. However, at the time, him and my mother weren't together.
Okay.
So when they both were leaving, it's like, what do I do? Because, you know, I had my elder sister. My elder sister, she was going to England. So she came to England. But I was like, I don't want to go.
It's either go with a parent or stay in Jamaica.
Yeah, and then my dad was very one of them parents where he was very, he was strict. Don't get me wrong. My father was strict. But at the same time, he allows you to make your mistakes.
Yeah.
You understand what I mean? And some people might be like, yo, how you mean you get a choice to, like, your father and your mother giving you a choice? Like, my mother didn't really have a say because I was staying with my dad at the time. So it's like, me no want to come to England. So what, I want to stay. So he's like, all right, cool. Well, you're going to have to stay with one of the guys that work on the sound system. So my dad had a big sound system that used to go around.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, he used to play, named Dan Pelico. He used to play with, not big sound, Kilimanjaro, BSADC, Black Cat, all of them songs we played with. So when I said that, I kind of said to him, I said, yo, let me stay with the sound.
Yeah.
Who are going to look after the sound? Because he was planning to just park it up, and because he was coming back here for a while to sort out things. So I was like, I will stay with it. So he said, all right, cool. And he left there with it. I had the sound system. And I stayed with one of the selectors, his name was Germs. And then,
do you know what, actually, just to paint the picture for some people who do not fully understand the sound system thing and having a sound, because obviously, you know, you look at a DJ now, and a DJ just has his laptop. When you're looking at a sound system, especially in Jamaica, the sound system culture was like, you know, the big thing that you had was the speakers. You had everything. Like,
it's
literally
like when
everything.
You go Carnival and you go Rampage or something like that.
Yes, when you go Carnival, you see a sound system actually strung up. If there was two, sounds that were clashing each other early on, like traditionally, it was my sound versus your sound. So it was my whole setup versus your whole setup. You'd be on one side and I'd be on the other side. That was one of the reasons why, like, just when I first started podcasting, and I was doing podcasts on my own. Red Bull had something called Culture Clash. And when I went to the one in Earls Court, I was mind blown, purely because they had sound systems. So they had four sound systems.
Mm-hmm.
You had Boy Better Know, you had Stone Love from Jamaica, you had Rebel Sound, which had David Rodigan and Chase and Status and Shy FX, and then you had the ASAP mob, when I've got there, to a lot of the people that were there, they're just like come there for an event and they're just ready to jump up and down or whatever, But to me, I was like, oh, rah, like Red Bull are actually embodying the culture properly by having everyone have their own sound system. Granted, it wasn't their sound system. They hired it, but that didn't matter because that was the sentiment of the thing.
That's the point. And I remember, yo, I was reaching out to say, yo, me want involved. I don't know how, but me who was sitting. No, that's how.
I'll never forget that.
That's how it happened. The host, I don't remember who was hosting it.
I think it was the host of that was Annie Mack. I think Annie Mack hosted it.
I don't know. Is that a girl?
Yeah.
Yeah. See, I don't know who's hosting, but people actually were saying, White Yardie should have hosted this.
Okay.
They say, why are they make this much better? But like, that's what I was hearing. So I was like, let me check it out. When I see it, I was like, yes, we want to do this. Like, my member message even Red Bull, like, yo, Soul Clash, yo.
That was a massive, listen, bro, it was a massive, bro, it was so sick, bruv. Like, I remember going there and thinking, no, I can't even believe what the hell's going on.
Yeah.
And then I remember saying, like when I looked at the lineup and that, and like what they was doing and whatnot, I was like, rah, like, do man them know that, like, David Rodigan, this is what he does. Like, David Rodigan, like, has Clash Man, like, for his whole career in, you know, the
all
ghetto
over the
of Jamaica.
All over the world.
When I'm telling you, this guy has gone against man like Ricky. Like, let me tell you something. Okay, so a lot of you won't know, like, Kilimanjaro, Ricky Trooper and that.
Yeah.
Ricky Trooper was a sound man who was killing everything.
Yep.
And has got a lethal tongue. Yep. A lethal tongue. So imagine you got, you know, someone like him, then you got a white man like David Rodigan in Jamaica, clashing man like that, beard dub plates and stuff like that. I'm like, yo, he knows what he's doing. You know? Like,
definitely.
He'll know how to, even though there's a young demographic here now and there's thousands of people or whatnot, trust me, he will know how to have people on his side. And for a lot of people, they were looking at Boy Better Know. That Skepta and Jamie and just like Wiley was there, everyone was, and a young Stormzy and that, I never forget that. But like when they were setting up, I remember when Boy Better Know was setting up, there was like thousands of youths all wearing like Boy Better Know t-shirts and that, and chanting out Boy Better Know, and I was thinking, rah, like something's happening. Like, I just knew at that point that like something big was gonna happen, innit? And them lot came out and they did their thing, but David Rodigan and Chase and Status and them lot absolutely bodied it. The dub plates that these men were,
do. They, like, that,
of
that's,
course,
that, that's their field. This, yeah, yeah. Stepping
and
into their ground,
and that,
so it doesn't matter. They're gonna know how to. They've been in different situations.
Yeah, trust me.
So they know how to deal with it.
Yeah,
why better know? Are they good performers? Sound Clash.
different thing.
It's a different thing. So I say all of that to say that
sound system thing.
So yeah, so that's what we was doing. I was kind of at that age, going to high school at the same time, going into year 10, and I was left. So it's like, what do I don't really have that parent now to tell me what to do.
Yeah.
You understand what I mean? And it's like, schools in Jamaica, if you don't go to school, it's not like over here where they will call down the parent, they start looking and they will get worried. It's like, okay, they don't know what's happened. The child ain't got, they will write letters, but where they're writing the letter to, I'm not there. So
yeah.
I'm doing what I need to do. I'd call my dad and say, yeah, man, school are going good. Everything good. Yeah. School fee. And we have to pay a school fee as well.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, we have to pay a school fee. So it's like, yo, I remember I said to my dad, yeah, year 10, school fee need pay, and it was like 5,000 Jamaican dollars at the time. That's like,
yeah,
I think like £100 at the time.
It was probably
like £100, maybe even less. Like
a 1,000 Jamaican dollars right now is about nine-ish pound now.
Yeah, so back then it was about that. Probably, yeah. Maybe a little bit less. And him send me the money, and how school used to work is like, we would go to pay our school fees, so 5,000 would be for the whole year. I didn't pay the 5,000 for the whole year, because you can pay by term. So you can pay half, and then pay the next half next term. So I was like, 5,000 there, pay for half, put the next half in my pocket, that's mine.
Yeah.
That's how I look at it, that's mine. And then that's why I kind of never go back to school, and I just stayed managing the sound type of thing.
Yeah.
We were playing out like Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, Sunday, all around like the Jamaica, we were going around and playing. And that's what I was doing in between dropping out of school and coming here.
Of course.
So that's kind of what happened.
It's funny as well, because just I want to add to this as well, yeah, that like the sound system thing in Jamaica is like, for a lot of people, a genuine career path, innit?
Yeah,
like, create your sound, and that you can travel the world playing music. Usually as well, I don't know if it might have changed now. I don't know if it's changed now, but like, you had certain artists that were more associated with a sound system. So you would have like, you know, Bounty Killer might be more associated with this sound system. Beanie Man might be more associated with that sound system. So you know that sound system that you're going to hear play is going to have a lot of like
Beanie Man. Do you know why that is? It's because with back in the days, not now,
yeah,
but back then, artists needed sound systems to play their songs.
Yeah.
So they needed, like, even though there's artists that still need DJs to play their songs.
Yeah.
However, because they have internet now and social media and YouTube is so big, they can just put out their stuff and hope, you know, like promote themselves. However, back then, it's the only way for DJs to be heard is if you're not on radio, you need the sound system to be spinning your tunes.
Yeah.
So it's like if I'm a sound and Vibes Cartel is coming to me and say, yo, we need you for play this. I'ma take it. Cool. Play this. Take it. Play it. I'm gonna play it like, yo, cut two dub for me. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Cut a neck. Every time I'm saying, instead of you keep bringing, just bring me dub.
Yeah.
And then that's how they build up that relationship.
Of course.
With them. So that happened with Tony Matarana and Bounty Killer.
Yeah.
Obviously no.
Tony Matarana's a DJ, by the way, is the sound, man. But yeah, go on, sorry.
So obviously that has fallen out now anyway.
Yeah. They don't get on anymore. And then they I don't know if they squashed that now, but because of the clash that Beanie Man and Bounty Killer had, I know Tony Matarone wasn't too happy about that and whatnot, but you know, it is what it is. But anyway, you ended up here then, in the end. So what, you ended up just saying, you know what, cha, I'm not going to stay out there on my ones now. Let me just come out here and see.
So obviously I'm coming up to like 18 now, and I'm like, what me I do? What me want to do right now? And me I say, me have friends who left school, fly go Canada, friends who left gone America, some come to England. I'm like, yo, I'm going to England to you, man. Remember see where I go on, you know what I mean? So, remember I call my father and say, yo, daddy, like, I want to come to England, you know? He said, all right, cool. I'll send a ticket. So, I send a ticket and I forgot Kingston, go collect it and thing. Remember I jump on the bus and go collect it and, yeah.
Did you go with the thought of going for a tiny bit and then going back?
Or
did you know that you was just going to leave and not come back?
No. I didn't have that in my mind. I just said, yo, man, I go to England for a bit. More go to England.
Yeah.
And I mean, they just get tired and say, yo, more go to England. More to change. We need a change.
Yeah.
And, you know, we end up, reach over here.
Wow. And what was that like for you, though? Coming in, what part of the year did you come, actually? Was it August? Oh, so you came when it wasn't like, hot, could have been, hot. Oh, so you got a false sense of England then, a little piece. Yeah,
till when it breeze
changed. Yeah, till when it start to hit September, late September.
You know that one day when you left, go out and the sun hot and you have on a t-shirt and your shorts.
Yeah, and you're
out till late and you sit on the bus stop, so wait.
Yeah.
Oh, that breeze that feels so chilly like in the mountains.
Yeah, bro, I'll tell you something now, man. Leaving this country to go to another colder country, or to live in another colder country, I don't know if I could do it. Yeah. You gotta give me the big bag, you know. The big bag. If you want me to go and live in Russia or something like that, I need the bag.
You said that there, but
well, maybe Canada I could do, because I heard Canada's lit still.
I could go Canada.
Yeah, yeah. I heard Toronto's a vibe. I booked to go to Toronto, you know. Nice. I was supposed to go to Toronto in September, but I'm not going there now. But I know there's a lot of people that listen to the podcast in Toronto, in Canada.
Yeah, man, Canada, nice, man. Nice place. Love it over there, man.
But yeah, so anyway, you ended up here now and then just like getting stuck in with stuff. But how did the comedy stuff...
That comedy time of my life.
Serious?
Yeah.
How does that happen, though? Because, like, you can't just go from... You must have been considered a joker from somewhere.
No. That even... All right. So when we left England... When we left Jamaica and come to England, ended up in Peckham.
Yeah.
You understand? Like, gigs I'm a bridging.
Yeah.
Like, they're running before them bus. You know what I mean? Like, all of them, like, from Peckham, I'm a bridging them. So, I was around them from when I come over here. That's where I was. Full time, not doing nothing, just dead so. You know, go college, but nah, learn nothing. Just, you know what I mean? Yeah. Just go college for the sake of going college.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we was just doing what young boys do at the time, out and about, traveling different areas, just getting up to trouble, you know, getting a couple problems with police and things like that over the years.
Yeah.
And then one day, you know, like, after a while, then I'm going to say, yo, the app called Keek.
What was Keek again?
Keek was that.
Was that the one where you chat? Like,
no, man, it was a video one. 36 seconds you used to get, and you used to Keek.
No, Keek. He's telling. It's Keek. I remember K-E-E-K. It, but vaguely. It's K-E-K-E, innit?
No, man, K-E-E-K. Keek.
That's it. K-E-E-K. Sorry.
So it was like
I know that it was like
a video app.
Yeah. Okay.
You can make videos. 30-second video. 36 seconds.
Mad, like I vaguely remember it, but I just can't. I don't know if I had it for
Keek,
long.
Let me tell you what Keek, yeah. Keek as well.
Google it so I can
was,
see
was
it again,
good
so.
Because one no sorry Keek was came about in a summer 2000 and
yes, I definitely remember
2000
that
and either 2012 or 13. It was popping off.
Yeah,
but how it worked is you have to have an account to see anything on there. You can't. It's not like other apps where you can just go on there and then watch stuff. You actually had to have an account to go watch somebody else's or follow people. You know what I mean? You couldn't just, you know, if you was to go look on the internet, you go to something.
It's kind of like LinkedIn. Like yes, LinkedIn, you have to have a.
So I had to get that app. Because everybody was talking about it, and I was on there and I was just watching, and then it's like, yo, I'm gonna just rant about something. That's all I did. I'm gonna rant. I'm just do a rant video and post it. Boom, 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 boom. People that like it. People that comment. People that say, oh my God, this rant's so funny. It's like, all right, cool. And yes, the white man talking like that.
Yeah, yeah. Had the like, element. Whoa. There's a shock factor.
Yeah, it's like, whoa. Hold on. This guy accent good. Did a next rant video. Did a next one. Doing other. Then start doing skit videos. And it was like, people were like saying, yo, like, you should do stand-up, you know, like, you're funny, like, your rants are funny, when you talk about things, it's funny, you should try to stand-up, and I was like, nah, that's enough for me, man, that's not me, because even my own friends, they was like, yo, what you do for the app?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, yo, move away, you know, dog, load that, you get me? And I said, nah, man, just try a thing, man, I said, alright, cool, and then, I just asked a question on there one day. I said, yo, like, this was before Instagram had even videos. Instagram never had videos at the time.
Yeah,
yeah. It's only pictures.
It was just pictures, yeah.
So
yeah.
It's like, this is the app that I was using. I was like, all right, cool. I asked a question. I said, yo, I'm going to do a comedy show. Who would come? It's in the UK. Like the amount of comments, like, was like over at least 600-700 comments saying, yes, I'll come, I'll mad. Come, I'll come. So I'm like, all right, cool. Let me find a venue. But before, I said, all right, let me try to stand up first. Because one thing about me, I'm not just going to put on a show and then make people come out and that's it.
Yeah, because I was going to say, that's like, you can't just, if you've never done that before, that's a big risk to take, you know?
Yeah. So I said, all right, cool, I'm going to do it. At the time, Slim, the comedian.
Yeah, yeah.
So me and him had a mutual friend. You understand? And, but I never knew Slim. Like, I remember the first time I see Slim, I'm a friend house, I come link him, and Slim was just in his garden chilling. I was like, oh, and my friend's like, yo, that's a Slim, and you know, the comedian. I'm like, all right, big up, let's come. I'm not really, like, I didn't know comedy like that. So,
yeah.
So you telling me that Slim, that means nothing to me.
Yeah, yeah.
I know you're Slim, not Slim the comedian, because I don't know you.
Yeah, yeah.
I've
never
seen you tell a joke, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's like, I remembered it. So when this was happening now, I was like, yo, I'm calling my brother. I'm saying, yo, Indian, yo, ask Slim if you can call me, please. And I give him a name. I say, yeah, more and try stand up. And I'm saying, yeah. I'm saying, yeah, more and try it. What me need to do? He said, just get a 5 minutes material together and one place there straight up you can come and do 5 minutes. I'm saying, all right, cool. And I remember it was on me and my partner's anniversary. We had about 15 people at the house and we was all having a barbecue and everything. Come there, and I say, yo, everybody coming at the front room. Everybody coming at the front room. I say, listen, yo, these videos I've been putting out for the last 3 months. Obviously, you know, people have been sharing them, liking them, commenting. Like, people have said, for do stand up. And I'm going to try it next week, Sunday, at this comedy club. But before that, I want to perform to Uno.
Yeah.
And then they're like, all right, cool. And I said, all right, cool. So I remember in my front room, there's like 15 of us in there or whatever. And then
that's cold.
Come
that's
in so and we just do a quick 10 minutes and, yeah, just get had into everyone it. And people are laugh and
yeah.
They must say, yo, like, yeah, I think you do good. And I said, all right, cool. Like, let's go. And then went down to the place in Streatham.
Did you watch anyone? See, before you did that, did you watch anyone to get pointers or chat to anyone? Or
no. Because that's one of the good things as well, is because one thing about me, and I like it, because I wasn't into comedy before. Don't get me wrong, I've watched Def Jam comedy things.
Yeah.
And I've went to see Kevin Hart's the only comedian I've seen live.
Okay.
At that time. I've never ever really been into comedy like that. So I never really had an idea of how to do things. I just doing it how I feel is right. And it's a good thing, because there's a lot of comedians, young comedians as well, and a lot of comedians on the circuit, they're like, oh yeah, he's like a young Richard Pryor, or he's like a young Slim, or he's like a young Curtis Walker. And it's like, it's not a bad thing, but it's like, it means that your style is similar. So it's almost like people can easily say who you've been influenced
by. Yeah, yeah.
And that's with me, that I don't have, no one has said that, so it's a good thing.
Yeah.
You understand? So and it's, you can easily fall into that, because even sometimes you will see a comedian telling a joke and you'll be like, it sounds so similar to somebody else's joke.
Yeah. And you don't want, you don't, as a comedian, even as a creative anyway, you don't even want that in your subconscious.
No.
You don't even want that. Like, so yeah, so even for me, if I'm recording say there's a trending topic about something that everyone has to talk about.
Yeah.
I will not listen to a podcast about it, because I don't want anything that anyone said, I don't want that in my mind for me to then, talking like this person or, do you get what I'm saying?
Definite, man. So, but yeah, man, went to the comedy club, was meant to do 5 minutes, did 10, was good, like,
confidence lifted
there.
Up now.
There weren't much people there, there's probably like about 7, so it was like, whoa.
Oh,
like,
shit, that's harder.
It is harder, but I didn't know at the time, because this is something I'm new to. So to me, it's like, this is new, I'm excited, like, let's go. Kane Brown was hosting the show.
He's funny.
He's hilarious, man. One of the best in the UK.
Yeah, he's a good host, man.
When I came off, he came over to me afterwards, and he's like, yo, you did really good. I like your first and the last joke, how you tied them in and stuff like that. That's very good. And I was like, thanks, man. He's like, yeah, man. And he was like, just keep going.
Yeah.
Then the guys who run the comedy club took my number and he was like, yo, I will call you. I said, alright, cool. Call me back 3 days later. I said, yo, you can come back in on this day. I said, alright, cool. Went down there. Did another. There was more people now. There was like about 50 people. I was like, okay. Did it. Was good again. Then them called me back again, and I was like, hold on there. So I called Slim, I said, yo Slim, how much time you for do free show before you get paid?
Yeah.
Cause these are free shows. This is me just doing open mics. Yeah. And he's like, nah man, once you do a man show two times, that's it. I said, alright, I call him. I said, yo brother, you're gonna need to run a little change there.
Yeah, good.
I said, no worry man, we nice. You're it. So, so I went back down there and they had 300 people in the building.
Whoa. Serious?
The place was ram.
Mm.
And I was like, whoa. Alright.
But your confidence is up because you did
because
two.
It's been going good and good. Yeah. So it's like, and the thing about it is, I'm kind of happy again because the first show I did was seven people.
Yeah.
Roughly about seven. And that's probably including my partner and a couple comedians. Okay. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, it was very little amount of people there. But it's good because I always tell comedians, even young comedians, myself, I tell them that if you see a big room, 1,000 people, and you go on stage and you get laughs, it's good. It doesn't mean you did well because it's easier to get laughs out of 1,000
people. Of course.
Yeah.
Because it might not be 1,000 people that's laughing. It might actually be 300.
Exactly.
It's loud enough to make it, yeah.
You understand what I mean? So I always tell them that it's good to do smaller rooms to gauge.
Yeah.
Because then when you get when you get 1,000 people laughing, you know 1,000 people.
Yeah, the percentage.
Laughing.
Yeah, exactly.
Trust me, like. So, it just went from there. And then throughout that now, lot of interest was coming in because Instagram started doing the videos now.
Yeah.
So I was like, yep, cool.
1 minute videos.
15 seconds.
Oh, 15 seconds, that's
it.
So
I was like,
right.
Boom.
Yeah.
On Instagram. I'm like, oh my God. I had 36 seconds, now I got limited to 15. Alright, cool, let's do this. So I was making 15 second videos now, making people laugh. Following was great. I was like, I'm gonna do my own show. I wanna put on a comedy show myself. Because what I didn't like is that I came into the industry and I respect it. However, I didn't feel like promoters in the industry respected comedians.
Okay.
And I didn't come into the comedy scene young. I'm in my 30s now. I'm mid 30s. Yeah. Like I'm 36 this year.
Yeah.
You understand? So I came in this at late age. So when I came in, I'm like, I've already got a mentality of a man. Like I'm not coming in as a young naive kid. Oh, I wanted to be a young comedian, and you know, I'm making waves on the social media. There's people following me. Loads of people like. Kevin Hart's wife was following me at 5,000K.
Oh, mad, okay.
I was like, yo, I'm not going to go be in a Kevin Hart movie. Obviously, that hasn't happened, but you know what I mean? Like, I was like, yo, what about you? So it's like, I knew that, all right, cool. How can I take the power out of the promoter's hand then? Because I remember a conversation I had with a promoter for I'm not going to call his name, because my name is good.
Yeah.
My name is good now. Yeah,
but it was a problem.
Before. Yeah, it was a problem because he wanted to, he booked me for an event, big event. Thousands of people. I did the show for £100 early in the career. So yeah, cool, £100. But when I come out and I looked like, and I'm counting, I'm thinking, all these people, you're paying them on £100? That's like three seats.
Yeah.
That's what I'm preening. That's three seats. 1, 2, 3 people pay for me.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right, cool. Next time I'm calling, I'm like, yo, I need this amount of money.
Yeah.
I'm like, no. We don't, you're new on the scene and that. I'm like, all right, cool. It's like how we work is we pay our headliners this amount of money, we pay the host, and then it's all about bums on seats. How many people can you put on a seat? So if your name cannot, I'm like, yo, my name's good right now. Like I'm growing on social media, my name's good. And they were like, No, I'm sorry, cool. No worries. Next promoter, same thing, no worries. So there's a lot of promoters that didn't want to book me because they feel like you just come on the scene
and you're asking for too much.
Yeah, and I wasn't even too much, but it's just because what they used to pay in headliners.
Yeah.
Is this?
You're basically breaking their status quo in the sense that they're used to running a certain formula by paying this and that, and they're looking at you like, oh, you're asking for.
So it worked out that, all right, cool.
I just do my own thing.
I do my own thing, and that's exactly what I did for like a year and a half.
Yeah,
I wasn't getting any bookings because if you don't want to pay me this, I'm not coming to do it because it don't make sense.
Yeah.
And I was doing my events. I was doing shows. The first one I did, the first one we actually put on was back in 2013. And we had to cancel it because my dad passed away the day before it.
Sorry.
So when he passed away, I said, I cannot do the show. Yeah. Good thing about the show, I didn't sell tickets. I only did a guest list.
Okay.
And the guest list was over 500. The venue could only hold 300.
Okay, so you would have problems that night.
Yeah, so I just said, you know, I have to cancel. Sorry about these people. Everybody understand anyway.
Yeah, of course.
Then we postpone it for a month later. Sold tickets. Place was rammed. People were standing all the way outside. We had like 300 people inside the building. Ram hot. It was summertime, and they said comedy cannot run at summertime. We did it.
Yeah.
I was running a monthly show now, like continuously monthly show all over I was doing it London, Nottingham, Birmingham, like I was doing it in different cities as well. And it's like people are coming out and the shows are good. I'm hosting a show, I'm booking comedians. I imagine I've just come on the scene 6 months and I'm booking comedians now. I'm like, I'm booking like from your Babatunde there, your Eddie Caddy, Slim, Mo, all of these guys, I'm booking them. I'm like, yo, come. I'm booking you guys. And when I call comedians, this is exactly what I say. I said, how much is your fee?
Yeah.
If they say it's 200, cool.
You give them that.
Here's your fee. I don't argue with them.
Yeah.
Because my thing is like, yo, we're trying to, and even though I know that you're not charging the other promoters 200 or 300 or 400, you're charging them 100, you're telling me 200. I will pay you 200 because to me, I'm like, yes.
Yeah.
This is where we need to be at.
Of course.
Because if you're not charging these type of money, then no one can come in the scene and make a living. Yes. You know what I mean?
And you can't elevate. Yeah,
it's a hobby. Like, I always feel like you cannot call yourself a comedian if you're actually, this is not your 9-to-5. If you have a 9-to-5 that is actually providing, that's what take care of your livelihood. Your 9-to-5 is what pays your bills. Your 9-to-5 is what you live off of. The comedy thing is not what you live off. That's not your career. That's not your job. That's a hobby.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I mean? And that's the problem, is because a lot of promoters don't respect the comedians and what we put in, the work that we put in on the stage. Remember, you know, a promoter needs us, you know.
Yeah.
If you're a comedian, if you're a comedy promoter, you need comedians.
Yeah.
You cannot just put on a comedy
show. Of course.
So.
So I think maybe that's an interesting one still, because I think the promoter's mindset is, yeah, I'm bringing in all the people or whatever, you just come in and perform. But you know what, yeah? It becomes different when that comedian goes off, does his own thing, starts putting bums on seats and that. Now you got to chat to him properly, definitely
that's
now.
That's exactly what happened. Did it for like a year and a half, and then these promoters were calling me now, because what was happening is like, our comedy scene, right, is separated. You have the mainstream and you have the urban scene. The mainstream is like the TV, the white scene, they say, the white scene. And then the urban scene is what they call the black scene. It's segregated. Many comedians on the urban scene, the black scene, are trying to get to the mainstream. And when they get there, they don't want to come back. So when they don't come back and they go, and that's big up to them. Like, if that's your path and where you want to go, that's cool, but I don't feel like you should aim to get there and forget about where you came from.
Mm.
Because what you do now is you make the world work harder because there's less and there's not many coming through. In our comedy scene, there's not many coming through. Like, there's like one every 2-3 years that are okay, are good. Like before me, I think there was, before I came on the scene, Diesel came on the scene.
Yeah.
And then I came on the scene after Diesel, a year after Diesel. Then after a year after me, 2 years later, Judy Love came on the scene.
Yeah.
Since then, there's Christopher Savage now,
who's doing
well.
Yeah.
But do you understand what I mean? Like, when you look on the mainstream, they just keep getting people, because that's where everyone's aiming to get. Because, and I can tell you this for a fact, the mainstream don't pay as much as the urban scene.
Okay.
But because they see TV, that's what they see on that side. Once we get on there, we get on TV, we get on Apollo, we made it.
Yeah.
Do you understand? So that's what they aim for. Where I was like, yo, we need to build our scene to get to that level where we can be there.
Mm.
Do you understand what I mean? So by me going around and doing all these shows, it's like when the promoters came back around, because they were losing people, people were leaving, going over to the mainstream, they called me and they're like, yo, yeah, they were going a long time. Yeah, man. So yeah, I'm booking for that show. Now it's a new fee.
Yeah.
It's not the one I was telling you before.
Oh, yeah. It's the next
because,
thing now.
and they had to come with that because you put bums on seats now. I can see that. Yeah, like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm touring.
Yeah.
I'm traveling. I'm going around the world.
Yeah.
So it's like the conversations were different, even though it still was being affected because the bigger head of comedians didn't like the fact that I am asking for XYZ.
Yeah.
And they're still getting this. And I'm like, you cannot be mad at me.
Yeah.
Like, Chuck, if I say to you, yeah, if I say to you, like, yo, if a promoter calls you right now and says, yo, they want to book you for host an event
yeah.
and co-host with me, and I say I want £1 million,
yeah.
and you say you want £1, yeah. and then you find out I get £1 million, you can't be angry at me.
Of course not.
You asked for £1.
Yeah, no.
So the man gave you £1.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I asked for £1 million, he gave me £1 million.
Of course.
So you had the opportunity to tell him what you
want. That happens in this game. That happens in this game.
But it's not right.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
not right, and that's has happened throughout my career.
Yeah, yeah.
You understand what I mean? Throughout my career.
I think, I personally, I just see that as like, all right, when you start realizing what the budgets are and what can actually happen and, you know, what certain people are acquiring, and you look at yourself and say, all right, you know what, maybe I was undercutting myself a piece, you know, next time I'm going to have to, you know what I mean? But no one can't be mad at you.
But that's...
Especially if you now have built a track record of doing your own thing. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, you don't have to do that booking, because you know what? You could put on a show tomorrow or the week after and put 1,000 people in the seat in seats.
But so this is what it came down to, is that they were angry because I'm asking promoters for certain money, and it's like, so ask me that. And when we talk about certain money, it's not no big money, you know. This ain't no life changing money.
I know.
Like, it's a reasonable fee.
Yeah.
Like, rappers would laugh at what we ask for.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But Americans comedian would say, yo, they would try to book an American comedian, and the American comedian would tell them their fee, and they pay that.
Yeah.
And have no problem paying it. Flights, accommodation, everything look after. But your local comedian telling you they want this change, and you're ball like,
you're being unreasonable. Yeah,
that's
yeah,
what I mean,
yeah.
and it's not right. So I try my best to like build the scene. As I said, when I book comedians, I don't argue with them. What's your fee? Cool. Mm. Here you go. You know what I mean? Like I brought this mentality in of, once you turn up to my venue, once you turn up to the venue that I have booked to do the event. Oh, Wagwan, here's your money.
Pay yeah, your envelope.
You
yeah,
don't
yeah.
have to. That means after the show, you don't have to look for me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No one's got to harass you.
Yeah, like yeah. I've had comedians like, no. Pay me after. I don't like being paid before I go on stage. I'm like, all right, cool. I'll get to the door girl or somebody to give to you, because yeah. I just want to make sure I pay you before you go on. So once you're done, if you want to leave, you leave.
You can leave,
like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? It just makes you feel better. You know what I mean? Like, simple things. Drinks, brother. Drinks, you know, all these comedy venues that comedy promoters just want to give you a bottle of water.
Yeah,
like not even giving the man him a one drink. Like, yo, you want something to drink, brother? You know what I mean? Like, yo, I was booking comedians, and yo, here's drink tokens. Here's drink tokens. Go to the bar and get yourself a drink.
Yeah, they want you to go on stage with a dry mat and no vibe.
Brother, some of them don't even give you water.
Yeah.
Trust me, like the scene is not a nice scene.
I'm telling you, it's synonymous to how it was in the DJ game. Trust me. You like, promoters are getting upset when you're trying to charge them a thing, and then after the dance, you're running up and down all over the place trying to find them.
Yeah.
Enough of them's left.
Yeah.
You get
yeah,
what I'm
yeah,
saying? Yeah. I'm all in there now in the dance waiting for my man to come with the envelope with yeah. the young something,
yeah, yeah.
and he's not even there.
Nah,
you want
the door's boy. Closed now, man's yeah. gone. Yeah? I've waited until 4:30 in the morning yeah. now trying to find
the one. Are you get the one about, Aura! Oh, Jay was meant to pay you, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Let me call him now.
Or you know what? Just send me account details. I'll pull it in there tomorrow. You know that's a long thing. Do you get what I'm saying?
Well, I never story about that when I tell it, because the person will get upset.
Tell it without saying him. Say his name. Go on, tell it without saying his name.
Boy. One time, one comedian booked me, yeah. Them. You'll tell you this honest truth, yeah. And for anybody that listen, like, I don't have issues with people.
Yeah.
But a lot of comedians have issues with me.
Yeah.
And I find it strange, because I never, when I came into the comedy game, I knew no one. I literally knew no one, no comedian, no one. So I could not be a problem maker. I cannot come in and be a problem. How could I have problems with you when I don't even know you? I'm not that guy. Like, unless me know you differently, I mean, you have issues on different levels, then we can have issues. But if I don't know you personally and never met you before, I can never have an issue with you. But a lot of people had issues with me. There was a lot of talk. White Yardie is a gimmick. Like, 6 months, we forget about him. this is what going into 8 years now. You understand what I mean? White Yardie this, White Yardie that, White Yardie, everything. My name was just ringing in the comedy scene between the comedians, chatting this, chatting that, chatting this, chatting that. But it comes full circle back around because one thing about them cannot keep them out. So then once you tell him until he come back to me.
Of course.
So this comedian booked me for doing an event. I never wanted to do it because it was like how they went about the booking. I didn't like it. He was like, yeah, I'm doing my show. This is the fee. And I'm like, I've never spoken to you before. That's I've never, ever had a conversation. You've seen me at 5 different shows. And you never even say wagwan to me once. All right, hello, all right. Wagwan, you bless and like what you're doing and that. You never once, and you've been in the game for years. Years and on top of years and on top of years and on top of years. And you see a young comedian, or not even young, but you see a comedian who's young in the game, come in, and you don't even acknowledge him not once. But yet you message me on my Instagram, bro. Yo, bless bro, I got a show. This is the fee. That conversation though, sorry. So I was like, yo, like, just for the record, that's not my fee.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, because I don't like the way how you came
I've had a bunch of them.
Yeah, still. Like, that's not my fee.
Yeah.
However, as a comedian,
yeah,
to a fellow comedian,
yeah,
I would do it for you.
Yeah.
Because that's
the better way of putting it is, this is my I've got a show coming up. I'd like to book you. This is my budget. Are you good with this?
Yeah, it could even something yeah, like yeah, that. Yeah, or, yeah, yeah, yo, yeah. I can afford this. Or this is what I cannot. Not this is the fee. Like, you're telling me this is what you pay. What, you ain't asked me nothing. Like, am I available?
He's put the price tag on you.
Yeah, I didn't like that.
Yeah.
So anyway, I was like, cool. Because I don't want to be a problem and I don't want to seem like I'm like, I can do it. It's fine because fellow comedian to comedian, we can work it out because in the long run, I do events, you can return a favor, simple as that. And your name is big, you've been doing it for years. Do the show. Do my set, come off. Go check man for payment now. Like, yo, I'm gonna drop it into your bank account. I was meant to get the funds released from the venue, but they didn't do it, so they're gonna have to put in my account and I'll transfer it to you. And I was like, alright, cool, no worries. This was on a Saturday, it said Monday dropping. So alright, cool, I text it right in front of me, WhatsApp.
Yeah.
There it is. Left it. Gone about my business. Monday, I get a WhatsApp message. I'm in a WhatsApp group with all the comedians that were on the show, including the one who put on the show. Yeah, just to let everyone know, sorting out the payments. No one feel like I'm not gonna pay them. It's just had the issue with the venue and they was meant to do this, meant to that. They still ain't done it, but we'll be done by Wednesday.
Yeah.
So I just put. No, I just said. Not even say that. I said left group. Left group. Cause for me, it's like again that's different. Like I don't business. You shouldn't have everybody in one group talking about everybody's business.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
You know what I mean? Like you don't. You know what I mean? So I left the group. I left. I came out of the group and I messaged the person, individual. I was like, "Yo, listen. Cool. Wednesday's fine. I don't need to be in the group. Just message me and tell me what I want. Cool. Wednesday come. Nothing. No, for me, it wasn't even about the money.
It's the principle.
It's the principle of how you're going about it. And it felt like everybody else was happy to how he was dealing with it based on who he was.
Okay, fair.
Mm.
With me, that didn't mean nothing to me, who you was. You're going to show respect and you'll get respect. Because I felt like this was like a more like a power trip thing. This was more of a power trip to say, yeah, I can control and I can say what's gonna happen.
Mm.
Wednesday, nothing happened. So I message him, said, listen, first thing first, I first never work with you. I don't work like this, yeah? And same thing I'm just saying, it's not about the money, it's the principle of it. You tell man, Monday come and gone. Put man now on group, I left the group. You tell me Wednesday is here, no, nothing has happened. He's like, no, Friday, definitely, I saw that Friday. I'm like, all right, cool. I'm gonna get to Friday. Friday come, nothing again. So I just send a message. I'm gonna say, listen, you need to pay me today. If you don't pay me today, every day that has passed since your show, my money gone up double.
Yeah, strong.
And I know where you're there. Mm. Just like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Strong.
I'm going to get my money like the same day.
They say,
So to me, it was one of them ones that I'm like,
that pisses me off.
That's jarring.
What?
No, because
it's, why have I got to turn up the scheme now for me to get the, you understand what I'm saying?
But that just shows that that was a power thing.
So the
thing.
Money was in yeah. the, oh, you're true, yeah.
That just sure is a power thing. And yeah. it's because, again, it goes back like, brother, enough fight, I go through, you know. In this industry, people own, obviously, you only show people what you want them to see.
Yeah, of course.
And I'm not going to sit on social media and be like, yo, people, may I get a fight? Yeah, so may I get a fight? Yeah, so I just get on with it. Because at the end of the day, I have two children. I have two kids and them are my priority. So me focusing on all the fight I'm getting and going on social media and being depressed and talking about it is not going to help them. I have to overcome that. And no, say, you know what, I have to be strong for them because I'm doing this for them. Everything I'm doing is for them and for them alone. So when I get to fight them, let's have a fight through it. You know what I mean? Like enough opportunities were on the table for me and them get blocked. I've been blocking this industry. I'll be honest, even coming here to do this right now, it's mad because I've been in the game 8 years and I have never been on any big platform.
Yeah, I know. When yet. I was even looking at doing like just a little prep and that, I didn't see no like nothing.
None. And every time I meet people, I'm not calling no name because I've learned that over the years as well. Stop calling names now. Mm. Like me now say, oh, I ain't been on this, I've been on.
Yeah.
But when I meet them in person, I'm like, yo, we need to get you on this and yeah man, I'm gonna get you on this show and yeah we're gonna yeah man, I'm gonna do this, gonna do that. And then all right, cool, here's the number. And then next week nothing will happen. So it's cool. Because independently, what I have done so far has got me to where I am.
That's it. And do you know what? Really, I used to feel like that sometimes as well, bro. I used to feel like, rah, like, man's been putting in work and, like, I haven't been invited to this or, like, someone hasn't put in as much as me and, like, rah, like, they've got the invite to X, Y, and Z and whatnot. But really and truly, yeah, see, like, when you're building your own thing and you are gaining traction from it, for me anyway, I start to realize that nothing actually matters, like none of that actually matters. I've got my own thing, I'm building it, it's like a plant, I'm just putting water on it, and then there's opportunities that come from it. Of course there's opportunities that come from it, but this is my home and I can do what I want with it, and that's it. Like I don't even now, because I've got an audience and that now, I don't particularly, it's nice to go other places, but I don't need to go anywhere else. Exactly. I could just do what I'm doing here. And 100. I've also even been on the thing of sometimes of like, when there's certain conversations now that have been had when we're not joking, but we're having a serious conversation about certain serious topics or whatnot. And then because of that, now you got certain corporations that want to invite me now because, you know, it seems like I'm a representation of what, like my thing is, nah, like, I'm not even going there. Just if you want, take a clip of what I said and you can run with that. Just ask me for it first and you can do that. But more time.
And that's exactly what it is. Like, even them people there where the BBC people, them. I'm not afraid to call them name. Even them. Go back and look. I have never been on there to do a proper White Yardie coming. I've been on there two, maybe three of them as special guests. But it's like, 5 minutes, brother, you could have called my phone. You could have called my phone and do this. You don't need me for come all the way up in a central London for me sit down for 5 minutes for just
yeah,
for do what? There's nothing about me. You don't ask me about my projects or do you ask me what I'm doing? Like, you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
And the other day, I just ignore them. And they email me some things that I just ignore them. Come and say, yo, especially with the foolishness we're going to go on with over here.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah,
ignore them. Yeah. You understand what I mean? But I just say, God, brother, we have to fight through it. And keep going. You understand what I mean?
Well, listen, man, you put yourself in a good position now. I'll tell you that now, man. You got some good traction. You had your Straight Out of Jamaica comedy special.
Mm-hmm.
For people who don't know about that, talk about that quickly, actually.
So, Straight Out of Jamaica is a one-man show.
Yeah.
Basically, it's a one-man show. Just like when you go to watch Kevin Hart perform and just him on stage performing for an hour. That's what a one-man show is. I did that in 2016. We did the O2 Indigo.
Yeah.
did that. It was amazing. Sick. We sold it out, and that to me was a big achievement for me at the time. Filmed it, and I filmed it with the vision of I want it edited, filmed, and be able to present to Netflix or any big platform. Now, the people I was working with, this is what was meant to happen. It didn't work out because promises, hopes, and promises what was meant to happen didn't happen. So I ended up sitting on this project for, well, like 4 years now.
Wow.
4 years, bro. No one get to see it apart from when I toured, because I've done a tour in America, a tour in Canada with
yeah.
it, and people got to see it then. But this video that I, this one-man show that I filmed was very special because I bring jokes to life as well. So you don't just see a stand-up comedian telling jokes. There's parts of the show where I'm like telling the jokes. I'm like, you know what? Instead of me telling you a joke, let me show you the joke. And the curtains open and there's other people on stage with me, and I'm narrating the joke and acting out the things. And we did it. And the other day I released it online on this platform again. I independently had to find somewhere to do it because, again, lots of promises, lots of this and that, and people just let me down. So I'm like, cool, let me get on and do it my own way. Found a site that I can do it on, and we did it for one night. We did 4 showings. It was good. We had viewers from all over. We had viewers in Russia, brother.
Cool.
I'm like, yo, I don't even know some of the people in Russia watch me. Yeah, like, yeah. Yo, you understand it, take me, I said. Yeah. I wonder if one Russian man just did it, bored as hell, and just say, yo, yeah. Watch something today, I just buy this. But we did it. It was very good, and now we're thinking about putting it back out again.
Do that.
On for a longer period this time, for like a whole week, and people can just go watch it whenever they want. They just pay and watch it. You know what I mean? So Straight Out Jamaica is a comedy special, independently done again.
Yeah,
man.
Well, let me know, man. When you drop that again, let me know. We'll spread it out on the podcast here and just let everyone know about it when it drops. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, man. Listen, brother. Like, it's been good to talk to you, though, man. Respect, you got a good. I know your journey's just, you know, it's. I don't want to say it's just started. I know there's a lot more to go, though. Do you get what I'm saying? There's a lot more things to do. I guess you've got to adapt now in the situation that we're in with the COVID and all of these things and the social distancing and whatnot. Mm-hmm. But you know what? In this time, people still need jokes and people still need to laugh, innit? So, you know, from when you just keep finding different ways to adapt and make people laugh, people will always be standing next to you. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Blessed, brother. Thanks for coming too, man. Yeah, man. Do you know what I usually do as well, yeah? I usually ask people, like, what is one thing that people need to see? And it can be anything. So it could be like an Instagram post, it could be a tune, it could be a clothing brand, it could be flipping socks, it could be anything. Like, what is it? Is there anything that people need to see or know about? Could be a documentary, anything, random. It doesn't have to be about you.
Whoa.
It could be anything.
That's a good question. That's hard. You know them questions, a couple of times in the interview and people ask them questions, I just put it on the spot. I think, yo, brother, why? Why never just send this, like, send that question, say, I'm going to ask you this. So,
yeah.
I don't know, but something when we watched recently where was a bit like, yo, this crazy, was Don't Fuck With Cats.
Oh shit! God, yeah,
don't even.
Fucking hell, blood. What? Don't even get me started, brother. What?
That guy was tapped.
Mad,
brother.
Oh my god, tapped, bro. And at the end, now where you see the man cross his legs and
that is what got me at the end.
Yeah. You lot are gonna watch that if you ain't seen
if
that.
You haven't seen it. But
it made me think to myself that is this even real? Like, is this a movie documentary? You know, somebody like It meant to be a movie, but they made it like a documentary. Come here, think to myself, this man really?
Yeah.
You know, it's scary to think there's people out there like that.
Yeah,
brother,
there's people out there like
it's
that.
It's scary for knowing how far the man go around the world.
Yeah, exactly.
While doing, and the maddest thing is the people who had the investigation,
Yeah, it's not.
Them zoom in on every little thing that the man.
Yeah, of course.
Screenshot this and, where can we buy this? Where can you buy that? And narrow it down to exactly.
Yeah.
My God. I don't want to say too much about people if you never see.
Yeah, there's some. Hey, let me tell you something, brother. There's some crazy people out there, boy.
Watch Outcry.
Outcry, yeah? Outcry. Good, yeah? All right, cool.
Documentary.
Outcry. Okay, we'll have to check that out still. Are you going back to Jamaica anytime soon?
I want to go back soon.
I'm going to go in November. I'm thinking about going in November anyway.
If things free up. I was there in January and March.
Yeah.
And I just come back. I came back literally before the lockdown happened.
Yeah, yeah.
Want to get back out.
I'll go out there. I'll go regular.
Yeah.
But you know it's funny because you know they don't like mental health and that is still a taboo and stuff like that out there. Yeah. But like one time, it was the last year when I was there, driving through now, St. Mary's. Right, dark now here. Next minute, brother, no word of a lie. Some brother come jumping out of the bush, painted in white, bro, with an afro. Brother man made me nearly crash into a gully, boy. I'm telling you, I couldn't believe it, brother. 1 o'clock in the night time, you know, the brother just come jumping out on me.
Yeah, no, I believe you. Mad people. Right.
Yeah, yeah. You get a couple of
them. I just
said
that remind me of, like, one night we had drive. Where I drop off.
He painted himself white, you know.
This woman jump out of the bush in front of the car, naked, just having a red bra and a red jump out. And we man break up the car. And then she just in her next bush.
Yeah. God.
I say, oh, that. But yeah, man, Jamaica.
Yeah, man. I love it though. I love it bad. Like, I love it so much, man. Seriously. And you know what?
That's where we're shooting the documentary. Where I want to shoot.
You're gonna shoot it. Yeah.
I'll show you the pilot in a minute.
Okay. So. Yeah, man, do that. Whenever I'm feeling like I feel like that's the place that I need when I need to be energized again. Recharge. Do you get what I'm saying? Like a good
energy,
recharge,
man. Enough energy. You know what I mean?
Sometimes and I need that now. I can't even lie to you. I need that now. But yeah.
Well,
I
would need that, brother.
I'm telling you. White Yardie.
Mm.
Thanks for listening, everyone. Also, by the way, what I might do is, yeah, I think I might swap the audio around. So I might have the audio, you might hear White Yardie first, and then we'll have the teacher talk at the end. But yeah, man, thanks for listening, everyone. Peace.